Deadline I will extend it for another 1 week. So just try for that. Not only you, for others also. Only two students have submitted as of now.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Pranav, I think you are having problem in submitting that assignment.
Yes, sir. My PPT was huge, sir. It was 53 MB or so.
53 MB. Why don't you make it as a zip file first?
Yes, sir. I tried. After zipping, it was 25 MB.
Oh, still it is. So I limited the file content to be of 10 MB only while uploading.
I mailed the PPT, sir.
Yes, I have received it. That's what I'm telling you. Better, I will just check it 1 second and you can upload it again, the zip file. So, okay, I'll just tell you, hold on. Okay, you need not worry about, because anyway you completed it, that is fine. So, okay. But please upload it by at least next week, okay? Onto that module. I will try to increase the size now after the session is over. Then you can upload it, yeah. Yeah, any other queries, please?
Sir, can we discuss about the question number 3?
Yeah, please tell me what is that question number 3 is. Can you please, because I am doing simultaneously, I am just connecting the Raspberry Pi. You please tell me the question number 3. You don't mind?
Yes, sir. So here we need to consider two system. One system maintaining a pump.
Okay. This is regarding the water pump.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So what is your doubt? Tell me now. I can recollect the question. Please tell me, what is your doubt?
So here, as we are using two transducer, so in the real scenario, we can use any sensor like EMT detector or like that. But in Arduino or in that fetching circuit, what are the components that should we use? I'm not getting it properly, sir.
That's what there are several yes, there are because that you need to understand the question properly and you need to reason out what are all the components required for that experiments to be completed. So that is one part there. Let me open the question once again to you. I'm just opening the question. It is, I think maybe it will be useful for all others also. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, can you see this question now?
Yes, sir.
See, in this question, I'll just read line by line. Please try to follow the question once again, those who are not clear with this. So you are considering a system to maintain a water level in a sump between the levels high and low. So there is a pump is there here. Water is getting poured into this tank. Some tank. So the water level should be between high and low only, between these two points. Are you clear with this first line?
Yes, sir.
So your water level should be not more than high, not below than low. It should be between low and high. So these are the indicators here. You need to put some indicators. One indicator as in high, another indicator as a low. That is what the first point that we need to understand here. So the two transducers, a transducer can be either a sensor or an actuator. Okay, please remember this. A transducer is nothing but converting one form to another form. And basically that can be either a sensor or an actuator. Now these two transducers, one for the high, another for the low. That's what two transducers are used to monitor the level of the water. The water is pumped out by those two pumps. So here you have water is going to be pumped. This is P1 and P2. P1 and P2, the water is getting, if it is to be high, it needs to be reduced. If it is to be low, it needs to be filled up with the water. And this P1 and P2 are connected to this pouring of the water onto this particular sump tank. So what is this high and low? High and low are basically your sensor 1 and sensor 2, or sensor S0 and S1. That is what here you mean to say. So how do you maintain that level? Because water is a continuously it has been poured into that sump tank. How do you maintain that? If it is high, what needs to be done? If it is low, what needs to be done? There are different conditions are there. That needs to be, conditions are to be monitored. If conditions are going to come into picture. When the water level is going beyond this high, what needs to be done? If the water level reaches too low or below the low level, what needs to be done? So that conditions you need to prepare on your own. There are different conditions are assume appropriate conditions on how water should be maintained and write the program using your Arduino simulator. So the following system can be controlled by an Arduino microcontroller using the simulator what you are practicing now. The pumps can be mimicked by LEDs. So Nibas, please, components here already it is given here. Nibas, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So you are going to use LEDs here. This basically LED on and LED off. When LED is both are on, what does it mean, please?
Both the pump are active.
Yes, both the pumps, P1 and P2 are on. That's what LED, both are on. If P1 is on and P2 is off, if P1 LED is on and P2 LED is off, what does it mean? Pump 1 is on, pump 2 is off. Okay. So pump 1, this is P1 and P2, the pumps are there here. So two pumps, two levels. For two levels, two sensors are required. Two pumps can be mimicked. Mimic means you can understand that working principle with the help of LED. That's what you mean to say here, mimicking. So LEDs are going to be there. Switches can be represented by low and high transducers. You can use a switch or you can use a sensor here. A push button as a switch also can be used. It's up to you what you need to use it. So the program should inspect the input switches at regular intervals and take appropriate action so that water is in between those low and high. Are you clear with this? When LED...
Sir?
Yes, please.
If we mimic the high and low with the switches, then the user should we shouldn't switch both the switches on at the same time, sir.
That condition you have to keep it. No, both the LED should not be on.
Not LED, sir. Switches, sir.
No, this switch is meant for. What is the meaning of switch here?
Means the switch button.
Switch here indicates that the level is reached to high. High means the switch is on here. When the water level comes to low, it means low switch is on here.
That will sir, be we hello? Will be doing, sir.
That we will be doing means
like that switches are high and low, switching them on or off. We are like we'll be doing that, no, sir.
You see that high and on means here the purpose is see, here you can put as high when it is high. What needs to be done? P1 and P2, can it pour water into here?
Yes, sir.
No, sir. When the water level reaches to high, can we pour water into this sump tank?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No.
P1 and P2 will be.
when the water level is low here, it means this particular low is another switch which has been on now. On means the water level has come to low level, that is on only here. Then what needs to be done with P1 and P2?
Both need to be activated.
It is up to you. Both, if you want to put pour water here from both the pumps, it is up to you. And that's what the conditions I left blank. I ask you to assume what can be done here. You put your conditions. Assume,
sir, assume P1 and P2 are emptying the tank, like they are pulling water out of the tank.
You see, that's what, there are so many conditions will come into picture here. It's not just only three, four conditions. You visualize the system now. You visualize means you please reason out, think properly. What are the possible conditions? You write your own conditions, and other students, no two students can have the same conditions most likely here. It is meant for...
But sir, how to check the water level? Actually, I was supposed to use the potentiometer as a water level high and low, the variable voltage. Is that okay, sir?
Potentiometer variable voltage, that doesn't make any sense here. Potentiometer.
Then, sir, and that is my problem, is that how to check the water level always, as I have two transitives, sir. But
you please think over it. You'll get the answer. I don't want to give the answer at this moment now. If I give the answer, sir, for high and low, it is over. The answer is, the entire thing of that question is over now. If you understood the question, that is fine. So if you are not clear of the question, let me know.
Yes, sir. I understand the question.
Yes, please.
According to the diagram, like here there is a flow inflow in the below the pipe, that below pipe, and these motors are pumping out the water, sir. So if we mimic this, is it enough, sir?
The purpose here is, if it is, that's what, if you are now, you went to another term called motors and all. If people will have different ideas, so please express all your ideas and don't look for whether it is correct or wrong, and don't ask me at this moment here. Each student can express their ideas. Please put your own ideas and put the appropriate conditions based on your ideas, please. So it should be clear. Okay. It should be clear in your solution. The solution should not lead to something that the water level should not be more than high, should not be less than low, ultimately. What you are going to have those conditions?
So condition should, that water level shouldn't be higher than low, and lower than low.
Yeah, not lower than low, not higher than high.
That are the main conditions.
Yes, here it is there, no? Yes.
Okay.
That condition is given here. Consider a system to maintain. Maintain means, what is the meaning of maintaining the water level? Very simple English words here. Maintain the water level in between the levels high and low.
Okay.
The meaning of maintaining the water level in between the levels high and low. What does it mean, please? The first line, please look to the first line. Yeah. Are you clear with this, please? Are you clear with the question now?
Yes, sir.
Please think over it. You'll get the answer. No problem. It is not a very big novel question here. Just to make you to understand what sensors you would like to use, and how do you program that one. That is the two important things here. Okay, I'm just...
It is okay, sir, in the real world scenario, but in terms of... virtualization, it is a little bit,
it is not very tricky, it is not very complex. So think about it, you'll get the solution. Anyway, I'll give the solution once the deadline is over. Okay,
sir.
So I'm just, yes, please.
Sir, I think what he is asking, that like in a simulator we have what we have in physical world, we have that in simulator, but water is not present in the simulator. So how to simulate that different height between water? We have to use some kind of quantity, like if it is below 5, then it is lower. If it is above 10, then it is higher. So we have to mimic this by using 0 and 1. I think that what he is asking, because water is not present in the...
Please, okay, you don't give the solution now, don't give the hints and all at this moment. Let the reasoning be done properly by different people. So different ideas has to come out here. So if you say that now between that 1 to 10, between that 1 to 10, below 1, it is low, below above 10, you don't give that numbers here now, because he will think in the same direction again. Okay.
Sorry, sir. Okay. And one more thing, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, many of the students have not joined the official group of like IoT, in which we have TAs and you also, I think. So, sir, please ask everyone to join the group, and I am sending the link to join the group in the chat box.
Oh, okay. Please let me, because the TAs are there here. One of the TA is now attending the session. Our TA, our TA is Arjit Datta.
Yes,
you can
sir,
see
yes, sir.
He is attending the session now. So your assignments are going to be evaluated, and he is going to help you in on that Wild Rudin Studio. Along with him, Ashish Gupta is also there. Two of the students, I asked them to join, and I have enrolled them in our course. If you see the list of participants, you will see in your course page, you see the list of participants. So in that list of participants, they are non-teaching, non-editing teachers. You can see their designation there in the Moodle course page.
Sir, TAs are in the group, but the students are not in the group. So I'm saying, sir, please, if students can join the group.
Hello, sir.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. Actually, what happened is that in the WhatsApp group, which is created for this IoT class, not all the participants, like total 45 participants are there in the Moodle, but among of them, only I think 15 to 20 people are there in the WhatsApp group, due to which these miscommunications are happening.
Yeah, so most likely. Most likely, even I am not aware of that WhatsApp group, to be very frank.
Okay, sir. Then we shall also include you in the WhatsApp group if you want, as well as.
Even I did not mention this to any of the students. That's why they may not aware of the MCS students are not aware of those things actually. So some of the MCS students have opted for this as elective course. So they are not aware of that WhatsApp group, maybe, most likely. Around 10-12 students are there from MCA.
Sir, MCA classes are happening separately, I guess, right, sir?
No, this is an elective course. This elective course is opted by integrated M.Tech student as well as MCA students.
Okay,
and
but they are
also.
What I'm asking, sir, is MCA students are also attending now?
Yes.
Okay. Then it is better that we post that in the chat box here, so that everyone can follow the link and join the group, so things can be transparent.
Sir, so I have sent the link in the chat box. I request everyone to please join.
Yes, please. So I think the MCS students, now we have integrated M.Tech and as well as MCS students. So let me just find out one or two MCS students and I'll inform them to.
I got it and I have shared with us.
Yeah, Gopal, are you there? Gopal? Yeah. Did you receive that WhatsApp chat group link?
No, sir.
Yeah, please, it is there in the chat box now. You can take this. Mumtaz, are you online? Mumtaz. Okay, Ritesh Kande.
She's replying in the chat box.
She's replying. Okay, I'm not able to see. So please do join that WhatsApp group so that you can have a effective communication among yourselves. Okay, let me go through this for this. Anyway, we are all the half the time now. Can you see that I have shared one screen onto my... your desktops, can you see that one? Okay, so actually this is the Raspberry Pi which I'm talking here. Okay, well, so this is one Raspberry Pi, which we most likely I will make it available through Wild Rudin Studio from Friday onwards for you to access this remotely. Okay, but now what we are trying to understand is last week we have seen how we can use our Arduino IDE and collect the sensor data. So that video already, the recorded video session is there on the Moodle course page. Those who are absent for the session, please go through it once again. Or those are having doubt also, you can go through it. So here now, from this week onwards, we were working on the Raspberry Pi extensively for different applications and for various features for you to understand. So once you install your Raspberry Pi with your Raspbian operating system, so your desktop of the Raspberry Pi looks like this. Very, you can see it on the screen. By default on the Raspberry Pi, once you install it, you have different IDEs. So you can see here, there is a Gini IDE is there, as well as Thony Python IDE. You know what is an IDE? Integrated Development Environment. So these two IDEs will be helpful for you to start programming using Python. So you need not install any Python frameworks at this moment, but later you may require it. But at this moment, for a beginner, you can use this basic IDEs. So here I am just using one IDE called Gini. So by default, you will have the Gini IDE. So it is a user interface is going to be there. So let us see some small Python program. How do you read the serial data? So in this example, what I am showing you is, so in the last week, we have seen that there are two can you see this is ZigBee XB coordinator? Can you see this, please?
Yes.
Yeah. And yes, we have another another XB, which is basically your temperature sensor, is connected here. Okay, so I am now connecting these two here. So one will be acting like a coordinator, which is connected to your Raspberry Pi USB, and other will be like a sensing system. So the connection for this, how do you establish the ZigBee connection, that I have given to you as a chapter. So in the chapter, I'll come back to this. Let me connect it and open the chapter again for you. So if you go through this, our course page, can you see my course page here? Hello?
Yes, sir.
So I have two windows actually. Please do not confuse. I have two windows. I'm sharing it from the two different systems. Okay, there are two windows for me. Please see here, on one window, I'm showing you software designed for data reception and analysis. This is one particular window. Can you see that particular notes which is given on the Moodle course page?
No, sir.
Are you not able to see the presentation, or are you not able
to? No, sir. In one window we are seeing Raspberry Pi, and another window it's you.
Oh, just hold on then. One second. I will just off this connection from one window, and I'll open the other window once again. So can you see now the window of the Moodle course page?
No, sir.
Yeah, now please, you'll be able to see it, I think, now. Little bit delay is there, so you need to be patient. Okay, so in the Moodle course page, can you see the Moodle course page now?
Yes, sir, it is visible now.
Yeah, so there is a material tutorial on sensor data collection and storage using XB. XB is basically your ZigBee protocol here. So if you open this file, I have given you a notes, and I ask you to come prepared for this today's session when I'm giving the demonstration. In the last week only, I told you. If you can remember it, please see here carefully. So what is this sensor we have here? So we have, if you see the right side of the figure, this is what the PCB I'm referring. There is a temperature sensor, there is a potentiometer, and there are three LEDs. And there is a XB. So this XB is basically a radio communication module, which includes the microcontroller, which already includes a microcontroller inside this chip. a small microcontroller is there, 10-bit microcontroller. So if you see here, what we are trying to do, this is the topology. The topology is you are connecting your base station, that is your coordinator, to your laptop. And this base station is collecting data from different sensors. If you see this diagram, very simple diagram to understand here. So you have one Zigbee like this. There is one Zigbee here, which is connecting, which is sending and receiving data to your XB coordinator, which is connected to your laptop. Instead of laptop, now I'm connecting to the Raspberry Pi. Of course, this second sensing system, what you see, sensing device number two, this is not there at this moment. We have only one sensing device, that is sensing device number one, which is used to transmit your analog data, environmental temperature, and the potentiometer readings are going to be there. So this particular setup, we are going to use it. How do you set up? This is the steps that is given here. How do you configure the Zigbee? So this configuration of the Zigbee, again, I'll come back to this in the after 1 or 2 weeks when we are looking, when you are discussing about the Zigbee and other protocols used in our IoT systems. So at that time, I will come back to this tutorial again. How do you set up the Zigbee? If you remember, this is the XCTU, the configuration tool utility, which we have used here, the XB configuration tool utility, XCTU. And we have seen how the data is collected in the form of your hexadecimal values. So this is what you have seen in this particular diagram. If you want, if you cannot remember it, once again, I'm connecting it. So I'm connecting this to my laptop, and I'll just show you once again to collect this. So I connected the coordinator. Coordinator is connected to this. And the Zigbee or the sensing system, this is what the sensing system is there. This I'm connecting it with some power supply through the Arduino board, 3.3 volts only. Now, if you want to see whether you are receiving the data or not, once again, I'm just minimizing the screen so you can see XCTU. This is the manufacturer. You open the COM port of this. Terminal, and let me just connect it again. So you are receiving the data here. So this is how you are, this basically, this is what I'm referring in the last week. This you are receiving the data of the sensor in the packets. Basically, the packets contain hexadecimal values with the starting 70 as a delimiter. So, but anyway, now our point is, how do we collect the data onto your system? This is only just viewing the data. You are not collecting it, you are storing it, nor we are processing it, nor we are visualizing or doing any analysis. Just this is only a wireless connection. A wireless sensing connection has been established between your sensor and your coordinator. So that, how do we set up this? How do we configure this? How do we modem? How do you do this modem configuration and all? So I'm going to explain to you maybe after 1 or 2 weeks when we are discussing about the Zigbee protocol once again. So I can take this example and we can show you practically how your data collection and how you are receiving the data in the form of hexadecimal. This is all the basics of your wireless sensor networks or wireless sensing systems. This is the actual real scenario where you are collecting the temperature data and how do you do the two-way communication between the two systems. This we can do it, and I will give the provision for all of you to practice also, but after 1 or 2 weeks. But now at this moment, let us understand one of the basic thing. Instead of the laptop, what I am showing you, I am showing it in the laptop. So let us not do something on the laptop. Let us do something on the Raspberry Pi. So what I do here is, instead of everything this, what you are seen on this laptop, actually, I'll show it on the Raspberry Pi directly, and you collect the data and store it on the Raspberry Pi so that your experimentation can be moved further. So that's why I'm just stop presenting the screen here now, and I will again present it from the Raspberry Pi. I'll just go through the Raspberry Pi and I'll come back to this. I'll just stop presenting from this laptop. So I am taking out from the laptop and connecting this to the Raspberry Pi. So I've just connected to the Raspberry Pi, and let me come back to this. So I'm on the Raspberry Pi now. We'll go to our Raspberry Pi. And this is your Raspberry Pi screen. So I'm just going to the programming option, followed by you need to open the IDE, Guinea IDE. Okay, now you see the program here, how it is very simple to start with. So I have not made a very complicated program, very simple program here, which is written in the Python. So I think you know what is the purpose of this serial. Can anybody say what is the meaning of this? What is the use of this serial package or the serial library that we have imported here? Can you see the programming code, what I'm showing here? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So there's a import package is there, which is basically serial, and another import package or the library that is time. The second library time is meant for you to use the time functions in your program. So something like you want to use the sleep function, then you require this time. Okay, now coming to the first package, this is basically your serial package. Usually the serial package is meant to provide you some methods which are basically related to your serial communication purpose. So serial communication means you are connected your coordinator as of now to your Raspberry Pi. So if you connect, once you connected to your USB serial of your Raspberry Pi, you need to access that port. So that port is being accessed using /dev/tty/USB0 USB port in which your Zigbee coordinator is connected, which is collecting the data. And of course, you have other parameters on this function, serial method function, along with the how many stop bits, how many parity bits, and what is the baud rate. So baud rate I'm given here, the by default baud rate is 9600. So with these two parameters, one is into which particular USB port you have connected your serial device or serial communication device, and what is the baud rate to be considered here. And create an object that is called your Seru, which is basically, it is connected and it is interacting with your serial COM port, that is basically your USB serial COM port, with this baud rate 9600. So once you connected your object, that object is, what is doing here, the object, this object, serial port communication object, what is doing is reading the data, which is the data which is coming to your serial COM port. So read, there are different functions, read line, and along with this there are different parameters for this function also, how many bytes you want to read at a time. Like this, you have different set of values which comes to here. So what I am doing here is just your object which is connected to the serial port is start reading the data. It means you're reading what is coming to your serial port. What the data is coming to your serial port, you are just reading it, and that data is going to be printed here. So once you print one particular data value, you just putting 1 milliseconds duration to print the next data value which is coming to your serial port. Just a small delay, you can put it a delay, or you can put it make the sleep of the COM port to not to receive any data, And for every 1 millisecond, the serial COM port is receiving some data is going to be displayed here. So once you type the program and you give the name of this program, you save it in a particular location. Now you can run the program here. So you can see once you run it, and just I hope you can see the mouse pointer here. So here, for every 1 millisecond, you are receiving some data here. I hope you are able to see the data here.
Yes.
Yeah, this is the data which is getting received from your USB serial COM port. Just very simple program for you to start understanding. I have just put this small read function to read the data which is coming on your serial port. Of course, if you have seen here carefully, that previously the data that has been received is basically hexadecimal data. This is not an hexadecimal data. It is just your ordinary data that is getting displayed here. Please, just direct data which is getting displayed here. Now let us go to, if you want to see the exact hexadecimal data. So I just put another program here, the same thing. The serial object, which is connected to your USB serial port. And that object, what happened is you are converting into hexadecimal value. So this hexadecimal value is going to be displayed onto your screen. Let me just run this particular program and stop this particular, because USB serial is connected to this. So I'll stop this. And now let me just run this second program, which is going to display the hexadecimal values here. So these are the hexadecimal values, if you see carefully. So I have not put any delays also. It is a continuous streams of data. This is the actual hexadecimal values. Usually any in IoT systems and IoT applications, please do remember that basically you are to play with only hexadecimal value at the low level data that is to be processed. Please remember that. A very, very important point. You will not have the data to be understood in terms of your integers or your ordinary string values. You will have most of the IoT applications, you'll have the hexadecimal values only. Okay, this is one. I hope you are able to see the now hexadecimal values which are coming. Can you see
this?
Yeah. Now here also at this moment, we have not stored the values. We are just seeing what is coming to your USB serial port. So to store the values, can anybody tell me what modifications we have to do with this small program based on your knowledge of your other programming aspects?
We can write it to a file, sir.
Yes, very good, very good, very good answer. So we just now storing means if you want to write this data onto a file. So it's like an ordinary in your C program. Most of you might have already done your C programming with file management. So here, what is that? Can anybody tell me now what is explained here? What is written here, please? Can anybody tell me?
Opening a file, tc1.txt, yes. And write it into a...
Yes, it is in the append mode. So that file is opened in the append mode. You know what is the purpose of append mode? Then what is written here in the... So let me just change the file name to some other, so that already, because while testing, I have used this particular file. Okay, and one more important thing also, you'll get it. I'll explain to you and I'll show you practically what is going to be the problem here. Okay, so I just changed it to dc2.txt and the append mode. And what is this B? What is this B basically?
The file of it.
Yeah, the file object. So the B is the file object which has been opened that is basically a pointer to this particular file location dc2.txt in the particular path which is in the append mode. And that file object pointer is going to write what is going to be written, whatever the hex string that you received onto your USB serial port, that same hex strings are being written onto this particular file. Okay, now let me just show you how, when you run this program, I'm just executing the program here. Let me just minimize the screen for you. Right, so that you can see. Okay, now this is the running screen here. So, okay, on the console, I'm just displaying the values here. And let me open the file in this particular path dc2.txt. Yeah, this is what the dc2.txt is there here. Now see here carefully, this is the file which has been written here, 7e followed by 7e is the delimiter, followed by 00162 is the packet ID number, followed by 00132, 00409B is the serial address of that particular sensor which the data is coming. Of course, I know the parameters I was able to speak here, but it is a continuous data which has been written onto this particular file, which is of course in the hexadecimal. So normally in our wireless sensor networks and IoT things, this hexadecimal data, we cannot understand for our data processing. So we need to convert this hexadecimal data into the another our understandable form of a string, and we try to process the data. That is what we need to do. And of course, this is because you have written this is while true, it is a continuous data. Continuously you are collecting the temperature data. So at what frequency we are collecting the temperature data, how to make some delays, and how best we can put the system to work continuously, number of days, number of months, years like this. That is all the all these things comes in the picture of when we discuss the ZigBee communication protocol. But at this moment, please understand this is how you are going to store your data. Of course, if you are using MySQL data, which is if you have installed MySQL on the Raspberry Pi or on other databases, then you can write the data to your database directly, and you can push the data onto your websites, and you can display the data onto your websites or onto your other servers or onto another objects like this. So you have to start programming from now onwards. How do you collect the data and all? So this is how you can collect it, you can store it. And the next assignment, basically, once I make the Raspberry Pis available to you to connect remotely, each one of you are going to write your Python programs to collect the data, to store it, the data, and to visualize the data. So these things are going to come in the next weeks, basically as a practical point of view for you to do some practice here. So this is the basics for this one. Okay, this is one particular demo which we have just seen. How do you collect the data from the USB serial COM port and store it onto your local disk and store it here? And of course, now once you do some data analysis, the data needs to be collected from this file and do the data analysis as an offline. But when you have to do in the real time, so how do you synchronize the data collection and the data analysis is the most important point for doing the things in a real time. That point will do it slowly once you do write the programs, and you can do the multi-threading process and other things in the later stage. So this is one small example, and let me go with another demo here. So this demo is basically along with this ZigBee, we have also seen another example actually. With the temperature sensor, digital temperature sensor. If you see, remember the digital temperature sensor. In the last week, we have seen the digital temperature sensor. How do you collect that analog to digital value? And how do we connect your Arduino board to Raspberry Pi? That is what our small demo is going to be there. Before going to connecting Arduino to Raspberry Pi, it means cascading Arduino and Raspberry Pi, connecting Arduino and Raspberry Pi. Can anybody tell me why we need to connect Arduino to your Raspberry Pi? Or why there is a requirement
to read analog values?
Yes, please.
To read analog values from analog sensors.
Yes, basically, please remember, most of the sensors you might have already seen in our discussions, there are analog sensors and digital sensors. So you cannot put your analog sensors onto the Raspberry Pi. Please remember a very, very important point. Analog sensors cannot be directly connected to your Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi does not have dash. Please fill in the blank. The Raspberry Pi does not have
analog pins.
Analog pins, or there is no provision to convert from analog to digital. Please remember, Raspberry Pi can understand digital data. Raspberry Pi can understand digital data. Why Raspberry Pi understands digital data? Only digital data.
It's a computer.
Yes, it is a computer. A computer is basically your digital computer, which is in the form of your zeros and ones. So this particular point of discussion I have given you in the first 2 weeks of discussion, if you remember or if you can recollect, or you please browse my videos, then you will get that information, the difference between Arduino and Raspberry Pi. That's why most of the situations Raspberry Pi cannot play very importantly with analog data. So people do integrate a microcontroller with the Raspberry Pi. And our microcontroller in our programming aspects as well as the experiments what we have done so far, we are using the Arduino as your microcontroller. So if you remember, I just connected. If you can remember this particular circuit which I have shown you in the last week. So the Arduino board is connected to which particular temperature sensor? Can you see this particular temperature sensor? Is my temperature sensor visible to you, please? Just hold on. I think I'll just stop presenting from the Raspberry Pi and I'll come back to this again. Can you see the now the temperature sensor here? The one which we have used in the last week presentation. I have connected the Arduino board. The Arduino board with this temperature sensor. What is the temperature sensor number, the model number?
TMP35.
Sorry, it is not TMP35. It is not TMP35, please. EMP35 is the analog sensor. The one which has the temperature sensor, which is connected by me in this last week, is basically thermistor, which gives you analog to digital values. Let me just show you once again here. I think please browse the video. So tell me what is the model number?
So KY028.
Okay, very good. At least you have recollected it. Deepika, very good. So KY028 is a digital temperature sensor, which is also known as a thermistor. If you remember the program, let me just show you the program here. Can you see my screen here? So if you remember, I'll just open the last week's Arduino board connection, Arduino program, which we have used here. Yes, please. Can you see this program if you can remember now? This is an Arduino program now. Please tell me what is this, what is the output you are expecting from this? Hello, am I audible to you, please?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
So what is that output of this program? Yes, please. No idea. At least tell
so
me.
We are,
so it will
LED is glow.
Yeah, low because
the digital value is high. Definitely, the LED on the LED pin number 13 of the Arduino board is going to glow. That is here. Okay, one second. I'm explaining you. The LED pin number is 13, and the digital pin is connected to pin number 2, and analog pin is connected to your A0, the analog. And of course, I'm using two temporary variables. One is digital value and another is analog value. So the LED is the put in the output mode. Basically, 13 pin number is put in the output mode. And the digital pin, where basically you are, the pin number 2, which you connected, is made into the input mode to collect the temperature. Temperature value has been, temperature sensor value has been collected and given as an input to the Arduino pin number 2. That's what you're seeing, and you're having the data communication between your devices in terms of 9600 bits per second. That is the default baud rate for most of your data communication experiments. Now coming to this, so digital value has been set high based on the potentiometer. You are going to set the digital value. So when the digital value is set high, the LED is going to be blown. Otherwise, it is made as a low. And now the actual the temperature value is been read, analog read from the analog pin, which is connected to the pin number A0. So that from there you are going to read that analog value, and that analog value, whatever you have read, that is going to be displayed here. And for every 100 milliseconds, the consequence of values are going to be displayed here. So here there is serial print. One is your digital valve and another is your analog valve. Digital valve, whether it is high or low, and the corresponding analog value. Both are going to be displayed onto your COM port. You can see it on the screen now. So 1N202 or 203 or 201, something like that, you get it. The value 1 indicates the digital high. Because you set the potentiometer to sensitivity to high, the digital value has been set high. If you change the potentiometer to the other direction, then obviously you'll get into the low. Only thing is this digital value, don't confuse between this 1 and 0. It is only for you to understand, to play with the thermistor. That is only thing. And the 202, 201, 203, these are your analog values. Your analog to digitally converted. This 202 is a digital number, but the digital number corresponds to the analog value of the temperature sensor. Please remember. That's what the internal conversion is there, and that is being printed onto your COM port. This is your COM port, which you are seeing the serial COM port values are getting here from your USB serial port. This is basically from the Arduino board. So these values, instead of seeing it in the Arduino board, let us see these values on the Raspberry Pi. How do you push these values, or how do you collect these values onto the Raspberry Pi? So from Arduino board, you are going to send it to your Raspberry Pi. So how do you send these values to the Raspberry Pi is, so just, I'll just take 5 minutes of your time. Anyway, this will be continued in the next week also. Just 5 minutes of your time, just hold on. So I'm just connecting the same Arduino board to the Raspberry Pi, which now we are doing the experiments here. I connected this to the USB serial COM port of the Raspberry Pi. So I connected USB serial of the Raspberry Pi. Then I will stop presenting from the laptop and I'll connect back to my Raspberry Pi again. Okay, so once we have connected that Arduino board to the Raspberry Pi, of course you can write the programs like this using the Python program. You can read the serial port data and you can store it from the Arduino board. But I would like to show you one of the important features, something called as Node-RED. So there is a Node-RED. You can see it on the programming side, something called as Node-RED. This is like a server which is going to be helpful for you to interact with your peripheral devices of your Raspberry Pi. So by default, your Node-RED is going to be installed. You need not install it on your Raspberry Pi. So once you open your Node-RED server is going to run, and you can go to the browser. Once the Node-RED server has been run, you can go to this browser with this URL 192.168.1.12.1880. Go to this particular Node-RED. And you can see something like this. You can connect, there's no need to write any single line of code. You can just play with these blocks. Play with these blocks means these blocks will have a lot of information for you. So I'll just remove this once for timing for you to understand carefully. So you can see a small example here. Just I'll not take much time, then we can do more things on this after 1 or 2 weeks. So I'll take the serial in. Serial in is another port which is going to be there. You just simply select it and drag it. And serial in, this is one. Then go to, you need to put it on the some display values. You just go to the debug and put the message to be displayed here. Double click the serial port. Double click the serial port and you can come to this settings here, the properties of the serial port. So you are selecting the serial port /dev /tty ACM0. and you're setting the baud rate, how many data bits, and of course, you know, what is the parity, stop bits and all. You keep it as a default, only select the baud rate to be of 9600 and the serial port. So you have different baud rates here. So I will ask the next week question, next class question, what are the different baud rates and for what applications these baud rates are going to be useful? Please try to find out that answer for this. Okay, now coming to this, you can have this. If you want to check what are all the USB ports on your Raspberry Pi, you can also see here. There are two USB ports are there for me on the Raspberry Pi. I'm just selecting the ACM0 and you just update this particular serial port to this. Okay, then connect this particular serial port. I'm using the node RAID here. So once your /dev/tty/acm0, that is your Arduino port basically. This particular connection string, you please select it and connect to your message payload, message to be displayed. So once you connect it, now go to deploy. Deploy, complete deploy, I'm trying to do here. So successfully deployed here and it shows connected also. So now you go to, now you can see, please see here now 1 and 203 and 204s. That is your digital value and your corresponding ADC values are now collected onto your Raspberry Pis. So this is just I like to show this one. And of course, we'll discuss more about this on the next weeks. So yeah, any queries here, please?
Sir, how is the program running on Arduino board without?
Already I loaded the program on the Arduino board, no?
But that was on your laptop, no, sir, like over here, okay.
Baba, Arduino board, once you make it as a firmware means once you upload, your program is uploaded onto your Arduino board, not onto your, on my laptop. The program is not there on my laptop. You already put that program on the hardware. The hardware is your Arduino board now. Is it clear, Pranav?
Yes, sir. So it will be running until we stop or
like... Yes, it is a continuous. Once you put your program in the hardware, it is a continuous process until an event occurs, until another obstacle occurs, until you make some other. That's why your program should be in such a way when that program should be terminated or when the program is, it should be a continuous one. The continuously temperature data has to be collected, at what intervals the temperature has to be collected. Like this, your programming logic has to be built before you upload the program onto the hardware, before you burn it. Burn it means you are putting the program on the hardware, that is your firmware. So that depends on the logic. Otherwise, it is a continuously. See, now you can see it on my screen. It is continuously reading the data only.
Sir, I thought the board was powered off in between.
Ah, powered off also not. Program is already there in that in the microcontroller.
Oh, okay.
Well, it is powered off means once the program is loaded onto your microcontroller, it will be staying until you erase it.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, any other queries, please? Okay, we'll continue this. Still, it is not yet over. So we'll see how the programs can be done from now onwards. And how do you access the Raspberry Pi? So I'll make the Raspberry Pi available to you from Friday class onwards so that you can also start. Based on that, your assignment 2 will be there. Please remember. Yeah, any other queries, please? Okay. So keep working it. Please stay safe. Take care of yourself. See you on Friday. Okay. Thank you.
Sir.